147 verse 1 says, praise the Lord, for it is good to sing praises to our God, for it is pleasant and praise is becoming.
Troy, thank you so much. It is great to be here. I'll go ahead and step up here, hopefully the camera with the web stream can keep me centered. I want to welcome you all to Grace Covenant this morning and those watching online. It is a gift to be here. I want to just praise for the worship team. I'm curious, how many of you guys have farming backgrounds? Or show of hands here. A few of you? All right. Well, those of you who do, you'll appreciate this term because the praise team is like the tillers that go out and get the ground soft. And I pray now that I get to deliver the word of God, which is the seed that the praise team has helped soften our hearts so the word of God can come in. So hope you like that analogy. And you saw a little imagery maybe off to the side there. My wife, Kim, is with me today, and my daughter, Anna. And she is loving to be walking around. So hopefully she'll stay in the back there. And then we're also expecting another baby girl early October. So things are happening in the back of our house. And Troy, you alluded to some other happenings. My friendship with Cal is because we're colleagues and fellow pastors in the covenant denomination. And it's such a gift to have our friendship. Cal is amazing. He's like our Red River Valley pastor's coordinator, and he brings energy. And I think the same thing he brings to this church, he brings to us as pastors. But it's kind of been an emotional season for me. I mean, not only do we have COVID going on, not only do we have the racial injustice questions going on, in my own personal life, I've been on a journey. And over the last few months, God has directed me to finish my time as a pastor at Hope Covenant in Grand Forks. And then starting next week, tomorrow, is my first day on staff with Young Life. Young Life is an international, not a Christian denomination or a Christian interdenominational ministry, primarily focused on reaching teenagers for Christ. And they're right here in Fargo, they're right in Bismarck, thousands of sites throughout the United States and around the world. I think there's over 2,500 staff just in America alone. But there's nothing in Grand Forks. And in particular, what they've asked me to do, some of you might know my heart, is UND is a big part of what makes Grand Forks stick. And there's all these students who were part of Young Life in their middle school and high school years, and then they go to UND, and there's nothing there to connect. There's other ministries for sure, there's the church, but there's no Young Life. And they said, would you help us start a college Young Life, and then not take those students and teach them how to go back into the middle schools and the high schools in the Grand Forks area and help reach teenagers for Christ. And that's what I'm excited to do. I just feel so just called by God. It's been an emotionally sad time to say goodbye to something I've been part of Hope for 15 years, but then to say welcome to this new opportunity. And it's right in my sweet spot of discipleship of college students and mobilizing them to reach the next generation. And I know that's part of what this church is existing. You guys have done some soul searching yourself over the last few years. It's not my first time. I've been here, I think, 3, maybe 4 times over the last few years. And I love being able to come to a church that you're in the same, that's a church family saying, what are we doing, not just to reach North Fargo, but to reach the whole Fargo-Moorhead metro area. And God's called us to do that. And so you understand a little bit of the journey that I'm about to jump into starting tomorrow. So I would covet your prayers. If you want to talk to me about it afterwards, I'll be around at a social distance level as well. And there's also, obviously, Young Life right here in the Fargo area. If you're, some of you may know about it, they do a great job, primarily in the middle school here in Fargo. But one of the things that Young Life also has, I just want to look into it, is they do camps. And I love camping. We're going to talk about not just camping, but going on hikes and retreats and all that kind of stuff. And my question for you is, who's climbed a mountain around here? Who's been? Yeah, there's a mountain climber. Love it. Got a couple of you. So mountain climbing. I grew up in Red River Valley, but then moved to Colorado for my seminary years, and then I moved back to Grand Forks. When I was in Colorado, of course, like, you go hiking. That's what you do in Colorado. You go to the mountains. And you understand, as you're trekking along, it gets a little harder to breathe up there, right? The air gets thinner, and not only are you going on a steep elevation gain, but there's less air. And you have to stop and kind of get your breath and refocus and then go climb again. And today, Troy read the passage that I look forward to sharing and bringing to you. It's Psalm 147. And the last chunk of Psalms is an incredible book because it does involve all those emotions that maybe you're going through, that I've been going through, emotions of, God, are you going to come through for me? God, I want to trust you, but I'm having trouble because I got these enemies. But these last, the last third of the book of Psalms, usually from 100 to 150, but in particular, these last 10 chapters are called the Psalms of Ascent. And this an ascent, obviously, is going up. And the people of Israel, you know, were living all, not all of them live in Jerusalem. Jerusalem's up on a hill. It's not exactly a mountain, but it's a good hill. And the people would gather from throughout Israel and walk at during the special holidays, like, you know, the different Jewish traditional holidays, and they would walk together up this hill to Jerusalem, and they would say these prayers, these what we call psalms, together. And as they would go, oh, okay, we're tired, let's do this song again. And then what Troy just read would say, how good it is to sing praises to our God, how pleasant and fitting to praise him. Okay, let's keep going. And then go and then take a break and do another one. And that's what I hope today. I feel like we've been climbing a hill as a country, as the church. It's been hard. I think there's been some real good things these last few months. I mean, I look at, like, some of you might say that you have more family time. That's been really good. But generally speaking, I think these last 3 months have been a real time of questioning. It's been an upward hike as a Christian community, I think. And so we've had to ask these questions. And this passage from Psalm 147, I hope, helps you today do what the Psalms did for the people of Israel. Refocus your eyes back on God. Taking your eyes off the challenge and putting it back on God. So that's where we're going to go. And I'm going to tell a hiking story for my friend out here and others that love hiking. So when I was in high school, I went to a camp, and it was, you know, part, much like this Young Life camp, so, and it was up in the mountains, and it was amazing. We did things like whitewater rafting, rappelling, and rock climbing. We just camp overnight and summit what they call a 14er, or a 14,000-foot mountain. But we'd have interspersed through it all, times connecting with God, and times connecting with each other. And I'm going to kind of parallel this psalm with a story of a hike that made a big difference in my life. So what I'd like to do is have a start with a prayer, and then we're going to go on a hike together. So join me in prayer. Father, I thank you so much. Oh, I know that many of us here have a relationship with you, Jesus, and it gets sometimes difficult to keep our eyes on you, the author and perfecter of our faith. And sometimes we get focused on the challenges and the heartaches, and I pray, Lord, that today you help pull our eyes off of that onto you. And maybe some of us are here don't necessarily have that personal relationship with you yet, Jesus. You came as a family friend, invited you. But today, Lord, just like the people of Israel would walk as a group, some of them are like, I don't know where we're going, where's it? I'll walk with this group. I pray today that those who are here get swept up in this walk, on this hike, and are able to just come to see you, take their eyes off themselves, and put their eyes on a God that loves them, for them, and is their provider. And I ask this in the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Everyone say, amen. So, let's read Psalm 147 together. If you have your Bibles, great. We're going to go through some passages. And the first one, there should be some good. Time to praise God. That's what we're going to work on today. Time to praise God. And the first few passage verses 1 through 3, all about praising God for his presence. So, the first thing to do to take your eyes off the problems is to put God is present. So, in my situation, I'm going to go on the hike first. I want to read about my situation. Every summer we go on this hike, we knew that we were going to, there's something that says getting out of our comfort zone, much like the lady at New Life said, they had to give up their cell phones, we had to leave all our phones behind, we had to go out of our comfort zone, but with an expectation that we were going to meet God. Listen to how the Israelites had this in verses 1 through 3. Praise the Lord. How good it is to sing praises to our God. How pleasant and fitting to praise him. The Lord builds up Jerusalem. He gathers the exiles of Israel. He heals the brokenhearted, and he binds up their wounds. Oh, do you see that? Do you see that in the first thing that as they're starting this hike, they remind themselves that the Lord is good, it's fitting to praise him. He builds up excited to meet God, and I'm so excited to see there's like over 50, maybe 60 people here today. You are gathered here expecting to meet God. I want you to start when you think about how can the Psalms help me today, take my focus off myself, and I'm like, God, there is a God who wants to be present with you right now. That is a good word. On your hike, that's step one, to know that your God is wanting to be present with you. Praise God. Let's read on. The second, verses 4-6, is the psalmist and the people of God are praising him for his power. So, remember I mentioned on this hike that we went on? We stop and we get to go whitewater rafting part of the time. Is that, once again, let's see, just a show of hands. Who's had a chance to go whitewater rafting here? Wow, quite a few of you. That's awesome. I want to show you a picture. Check it. It's going to come up in just a minute. I'm going to show a picture of what whitewater rafting would be like. This is in Colorado, mind you, and it really is whitewater, and it's my visual of what power can look like. All right, they're going to blow it up for you here. That is crazy whitewater. Okay, so I'm Keith. You can see my face right there, but do you see where it says me? That's my friend Bill. He took the, or he had the friend the photo taken. He's barely under the water. You can just see, like, it's just encapsulating us, just pouring over us. I mean, we're going to, like, if we didn't have the guy in the back, he's the guy. He got us out. We didn't drown, obviously. But I thought we were done. The power of that river just forced all over us. And one of the things the people of God did on their hikes up to Israel is they reminded not only is God present, but God is powerful. Oh, God is powerful. Let's see how they say God is powerful. Verses 4-6. I'll go back to the verses here. Here it comes. Make sure you say that prayer, God is good, God is great. This is kind of, this is the greatness of God. You open the verses there. Okay. There it is. He determines the number of the stars and calls them each by name. Great is our God, mighty in power. His understanding has no limit. The Lord sustains the humble, casts the wicked. Oh, we got some power being expressed here. The people of God, as they're hiking up to Israel, up to Jerusalem, they are thinking about the power of God to do these things. Put the stars in place. Oh, I was telling you a quick story of my daughter. She's so fun. We've been sitting outside at night now, and she's like, looks up, and she goes, star, star. And it's so fun to have this little star maker in the house, but she had no idea there was real stars outside. And I just think, God made the stars. God is our Lord. His mighty in power. His understanding has no limit. He sustains the humble and casts the wicked. Have you thought about the power of God? Maybe you just need a breather right now. And maybe like that white water trip, that reminded me, there is power that God has put out. He has authority. He has power. When you're going through hard times, stop. Not only remember that his presence gives you power. He is the source, and he shares all his power with you. All right. Now, the next day on our hiking, we move along. We get to do what's called rappelling and rock climbing. And so basically this sheer cliff wall. We climb up it, and we're all tied in, but it's super scary. And I think the scariest part, though, is once you get to the top, then you have to reverse it. You have to back off the cliff and just bounce down rappelling. And that's it's a thrill, but it's so scary. And this idea of just when you're at the top, before you rappel down, you can look out over the whole valley and see this place. And it's just this planet. You see this. And that's what I want to talk about next. Praising God for his mind. This was the people of God, their words, to reorient and recalibrate their hearts. They said things like this, verses 7-10. Sing to the Lord with grateful praise. Make music to our God on the harp. Interesting, you're not carrying a harp on the hike. That's gotta be crazy. He covers the sky with clouds. He supplies the earth with rain and makes grass grow on the hills. He provides for the cattle and for the young ravens when they call. His pleasure is not in the strength of the horse, nor his delight in the warrior. This is a God who creates, he sustains, he makes a plan of work. You guys probably know Israel, very much a dry land, deserty. What does he talk about? talks about it supplies rain. He makes grass grow on the hills. He provides food for the cattle. Even the birds, the ravens get provided for. This earth, this planet, they took time to remember if God is with us, he's powerful, and he sustains this planet, he's worthy to focus. So if you know God, this is your time to kind of reorientate your heart, rethink about it, go, it's time to put my eyes on him. I think about being on the top of that repelling rock climbing hill and looking out and going, God is the maker of all this. If he makes all this, he can make me. What is it for you? How are you going to be able to praise God and think about God when you look around at the earth, the stars? Is there something that you can do to recalibrate your heart? All right, so people of Israel, next, move on. And in our situation, my story, is his people, praising God for his people. And so when I think about this hike and all this, one of the greatest parts of it was I wasn't alone. I was with friends, people doing this life together. I'm looking around at y'all. Look at this. There's 50, 60, some of you here today. You're not alone. What a good thing. If you feel like it's been a hard climb these last few months, which it has, rejoice that you're not alone. Yeah. Let's look at what the people of God said on the way up the mountain. Verse 11 through 14. The Lord delights in those who fear him, who put their hope in his unfailing love. Extol the Lord, Jerusalem. Praise your God, Zion. He strengthens the bars of your gates. It sounds like a military term. We're bars of gates. It's like keeping the people together. He's going to strengthen the bonds that hold grace covenant together. And what does it say? And blesses your people within you. Oh, God wants to bless people who are part of the family of God. It goes on to say, he grants peace to your borders and satisfies you with the finest of wheat. God must have been like the coding or something like that. Loves that wheat growing right there. But the whole idea that God loves his people. And I know on that trip, on those hiking trips for me, oh, I love that I wasn't alone and we could banter and have times together. And it's so good to do this together. So when you are needing to recalibrate your heart, Psalm 147, help the people of old. Help around, there's a God that's present, that has power, that created a beautiful planet. Put you with a bunch of good people. Okay, it's getting good. Let's keep going. The people of God have a few more summits to get to before we're done. So the next one is praising God for his potency. Oh, there's a term, potency. There's some oomph to God. Verses 15 through 18. I want to see what it says. It says, he sends his command to the earth. His word runs swiftly. He stretches the snow like wool, scatters the frost like ashes. He hurls down his hail like pebbles. Who can withstand his icy blast? He sends his word and melts it. He stirs up his breezes and the waters. Oh, all right. Once again, this is kind of like in the term, the powerful potency. The fact that people of Israel, like, we need to remember this God is powerful. So I want to tell you a little more of the story here. On my hikes on those days going up these mountains, first day was white water, next day was, you know, rock climbing and rappelling. Third day was summiting the 14er. And summiting the 14er is a couple of things. You're above tree line. So not only are you sucking in for air, but you're way above tree line. So when the wind blows, there's no protection. When the lightning comes, you're the tallest thing standing, so you gotta get off of it. You know, this is pretty crazy stuff, but we would go up this. And what God described to the people of Israel, things like hail, things like icy blasts, things like, you know, snow like wool. I remember all of those elements. We go in the summer, but you know the mountains. All those elements can happen in the summer. And I remember one time we were camping. And sure enough, at our tent, the rain started with like a freezing rain. And then we could tell it was snowing, and then we saw the sag coming in our tent. It came lower and lower, and then the poles broke, and we were like, ah! And the whole, like, the tent was gone, because, you know, the whole weight of the snow. And, like, this is what happens. When you climb, it's hard. But you gotta remember that our God has the power to do things. God has potency. He's the one that's in charge of all these things. Those memories we had that our God was for us and had authority to do things with power, so comforting. I don't said, when I'm going to my next journey right now, this type of stuff gives my heart calmness. If God is for me, He's going to go before me. And I want Grace Covenant to know, if God is for you, He's going to go before me. Guess the power. All right, we're getting near the top. We're almost in Jerusalem, the people of Israel, but there's a few more things they want to praise God for. The next thing they want to praise God for is His personal relationship. Let's read about that, verses 19 through 20. He has revealed His word to Jacob, His laws and His decrees to Israel. He has done this for no other nation. They do not know His laws. Praise them. Okay, so people of Israel, they're nearing Jerusalem. They're almost there. And this is their final praise set. Like, what do you think? They praise Him because His word is revealed to Jacob. Jacob's another word for the people of Israel. His laws and decrees to Israel, people of God. I don't know if you think about that. We kind of, I know myself, I said, well, of course I expect God to make Himself known in my, the emotions of my heart. But here, God said He reveals Him by giving laws, decrees, and His word. I'm doing a lot right now to try and help my daughter understand Jesus, the Bible, you know, singing little songs, the B-I-B-L-E, that's the book for me, all these little songs that we sing. Why treasure that God has revealed Himself? And I'm going through some harder times and some of the scariness of what the future holds for me, the future holds for Grace Covenant. You look the Bible as a God's gift. He's giving you His word, giving you perspectives, rules that will help you live life to the best. And some of us will view rules as like bad things. God's rules or God's law or God's word gives life. And I hope you cherish it again. I know for me, this idea of a personal relationship that God, He revealed His word to me. People, like back 2,000 years ago when they were hiking towards Jerusalem, that was a gift. They got it. That God had revealed to them. A lot of people had no clue. Do we thank God that He's revealed that He wants a personal relationship with every single person in this room, every person online? And I just, on this camp, that was my high point of the camp. After we finished the summit, we came back into the base camp, we gathered together, we told stories of how God had met us. For some of those students, God had become their personal savior. And when I think about that, there's nothing that brings more praise and gives me more hope and more confidence when I know that God is for us. And when you talk about the gentleman that had a casual faith and now has a live faith, I think we need those stories, folks, because sometimes we get kind of like just going through the heartache of the climb. And now it's time to remember how good that is. So I close with one Psalm 147. It's time to praise God. Praising God for His providence. He cares and His guidance is over creation. But it's more than that. He offers to have it over you. And so, as I close, I want you to consider. Some of you know God. Maybe you just need, I pray that maybe this one, the 147th Psalm, stirred your heart, gave you some hope, gave you some courage. You're on a climb, but He's with you. He's giving you provision. He's giving you promises. He's giving you His power. He's giving you a personal relationship. If you're new and just coming along for the climb, consider this God. He is worth it all. So I close with a final prayer at this point. Heavenly Father, it is so good to know that You have called us. You have made it personal. This is not an abstract, just basic teachings for a holy life. This is like, I know You, and I want a relationship with You. And I pray for those of us who are going through some steeper climbs. There's something in it right now that says, You get it, and You offer life, and love, and power, and You promise to go before us, and our best days are still ahead. Oh, Jesus. And for those that don't know You fully yet, may today June 14th.